at the Hall of Justice.
And here we go.
Welcome to this week's episode of Angrygeeks. I am the Tower of Power. I'm too sweet to be sour. I'm funky like a monkey. You know who I am. I'm the one and only Lewis Perry, the man with the plan, the man with the wristbands. I got backstage a creator who's been on many times, but I've never been on his podcast. He's an award-winning podcaster. He's an author, comic book creator, and none of my co-hosts show up tonight. I ain't paying him this month, but the guy I was just bringing up and I was smooching because I want to be in one of his books. And on his show, the one and only Mike Spring. What's going on, brother? How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. Until, you know, I got to be on your show, you know, Mr. Award-winning podcaster.
Okay.
Mr. There's... whatever.
You know, here's the thing. Sometimes when you...
Oh, I hate that. Do not say, here's the thing. Okay. And I'm going to tell you why.
Let me rephrase that.
Hold it. I got to tell you a story. So you open the door. You open Pandora's box. Right. I got to tell you a story. This is why you do not say, here's the thing to me.
Okay.
I got a work little brother. Okay. Mm-hmm. Work little brother. And he works for the Angrygeeks. He's one of the camera guys. He's one of the gophers. He comes in. And every day I say, D, because his name is Duncan. We all call him Donuts. I need you to do something. Robert Patrick calls him a rocket scientist. Because the kid is a boy genius. Sure. He is Jimmy Neutron personified. And he always comes in with an excuse. And he starts off with, here's the thing.
Right.
Never, okay. Right. Ever say that. Anyway, go ahead.
Fair enough. No, that's all right. So sometimes when you write a bio, you know, you're trying to make yourself sound impressive. So I am technically a three-time award-winning podcaster. for a business podcast that I used to produce and co-host for one of my jobs. Now, my own personal podcast that I have after the ending, the film podcast, that is not an award-winning podcast. So when you say you want to be on the show, that's fine. Here, we've never had guests on our show. Because it's kind of a weird format because of the way we like make up endings for films. Yeah. So it's like sort of like we tried it once and it didn't go so well because trying to have people write things like almost like fictional stories is not always great if people aren't ready to tackle that. So we just never had guests on our show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
But that's why you haven't been invited. It's nothing personal.
Yeah.
That no one invited. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. I get it.
Maybe I'll make an exception for you, Lewis. But I do like the idea of writing you into a comic, though.
That I like that.
Right? So that.
Oh, you had me at.
You're already a character. Yeah. You know what I mean? So, like, it's not going to be hard to find a way to fit you into a comic book. So I like that idea.
Well, thank you very much. Is it the hat? Is it too much?
Is it this hat? I love the hat. I'm a little bit jealous of your hat. And when I say a little bit, I mean a lot, because I think it's
This is a brand new hat tonight. I wore this especially for you, my man.
I appreciate that. I think it's one of the coolest things I've ever seen.
This is a brand new Macho Man hat that I'm wearing here tonight. Brand new shades, brand new everything.
I look terrible in hats. I cannot pull off hats.
Really?
And people are like, no, I bet you look fine in hats. And I'll try a hat on. I'll look at my wife and she'll be like, no. And I'm like,
I tell you what.
Yes.
I will have my Rose make you a Macho Man cowboy hat, and we'll send it your way.
Listen, I would love that. I would love that. I would be all over that. Yeah. I would rock that hat.
Because unlike other Macho Man cosplayers, we make our own stuff. Yeah,
I dig it.
We'll make you a hat, and we'll send it to you.
All right, I love that. I'm all about all that. Right. I will plaster you with pictures of me rocking the hat.
Not naked, I hope.
No, I definitely.
Oh, okay, all right, good. You had me scared, brother. You know what I'm saying?
Let's be honest. You know, that's another thing. When sometimes I'll look at my wife and I'll be like, "Should I be naked?" And she'll be like, "No." So you know, there's a little bit of a trend here.
Okay, all right. So 8-bit slasher. We got the Kickstarter going. The pledges are up there. I'm seeing it. We're gonna pull up the Kickstarter page in a bit.
Yep.
Let's bring up the villain. Oh, look at that. This is, I mean, we got some cool stuff. Can I bring up some of the covers? Bring up some of the covers, dude.
Yeah.
Bring up.
Means.
Look at, I mean, this stuff is wild. Yeah. I did have one person that is Maya is her name. She is a gamer.
Uh-huh.
She is a cosplayer. She loves horror.
Okay.
And I said, dude, I have a guest on tomorrow night. I need you to be on the show with me. She goes, I'm freaking working. I can't. I did show her this stuff.
Okay.
She goes, this is awesome.
All right.
I'm like, I know, but too bad you're working. You can't be here. So I wanted to give Maya a shout out. What can you tell me about this? Now, I use that specific one, that image for our thumbnail.
Yep.
Because I'm digging it. Where did the idea for this come from?
You know, that's a good question. I wish I could remember the exact moment of inspiration that hit me. I don't know that I remember it specifically. I just remember at some point the idea of, I saw something somewhere about, like, you know, 8-bit graphics or 64-bit graphics, something to do with video games. And it just sort of clicked in my head and was like, I had been wanting to do a slasher comic book for a while because I really like slasher films. I've always been a big fan of them, but it was like, I need a twist, right? There's enough slasher stuff out there that, like, just being a regular slasher is kind of like, okay, been there, done that. And I saw something about video games that had nothing to do with slashers at all, but suddenly the name of the book clicked into my head, the 8-bit slasher. And that was the idea, and the name kind of happened at the exact same time, right? And I was like, that's it. It's the 8-bit slasher. He's a video game slasher. He comes to life, right? Starts killing kids, and there's all kinds of video game stuff going on around them that they have to deal with as well. And that's where it all started, you know? And then of course it became what you just showed. Which is kind of how my normal process works.
But the story, I mean, I love it. You know, it's like college party, an ancient book, video games. To me, I'm like, what the hell could go wrong?
Right.
It's perfect. It's absolutely perfect. If you're a horror fan, you got to back this project, okay? Right now, you're at $5,809. Your goal is $7,500. You have 194 backers. You got 3 days to go.
Yep.
Let's get this book up. We got to get it. I'm telling you now, you got my word. I am pledging tonight. I want this book. Let's start, before we show the fans, let's start talking about some of the rewards. You always have kick-ass rewards. Red, White, and Broke had kick-ass rewards. Kate had kick-ass rewards. Let's talk about the rewards for 8-Bit Slasher.
Sure, absolutely. So the main thing is, as I always like to say, I'm a big fan of making sure there's something for everybody. So I always do 5 covers for my books, and which is a funny thing for me, because as a collector, I'm like, enough with the variant covers. But as a creator, you kind of have to have them on Kickstarter to get people, create people's interest. So what I usually do is one main cover. That's the one that's showing right now. That was just there a second ago. That's our main cover. That's kind of our entry level, right? It's like $12, mm-hmm. cheapest one. If you just want to read the book, there you go. That's the cheapest I can make it without losing money. Then we have 4 different variant covers, and they, they're a little bit more expensive because chances are good they're going to be limited. After a while, I'll stop printing them. This has been our most popular one. This is the Friday.
Really?
Yes, people, because it's an homage to the Friday the 13th Super Nintendo or Nintendo video game.
Yeah, I get it.
Right, and people have traumatic memories of that game, because once we put it out there, everybody who talks about it always tells me, they're like, oh my God, I love that game. It was the hardest game ever. Every single person who talks about this game will talk about how impossible it was to beat this game. And people have a real affinity for it. And so it's been this one's been a real big seller for us. And I think that partly because the artwork, but also the graphics, the way it really mirrors having the Nintendo, it's all taken right out of a Nintendo ad for that game. So all of the stuff matches up to it. This is my homage to Alfred Hitchcock, Psycho. Big Hitchcock fan. The famous shower scene is also, Psycho is kind of considered by some people to be the first slasher movie, right? So I want to
pay
homage to that. We got that with the logo. And then this is my Ryan Brown cover. Ryan Brown is a superstar cover artist. He's just did a cover for Thundercats, which has been a big hit. He's done Ninja Turtles. Mm-hmm. He's done Usagi Yojimbo. He's done He-Man. You name it. He's done it all.
No.
And so
this is my favorite cover right here.
Yeah,
he did this one. That's why I use that one. I mean, I freaking love this cover. Another cover. yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
I love that cover.
Thank you.
So when you have, again, you always have 5 covers for every book. And I never asked you this question. Do you tell your cover artist, go ahead, do your thing, or this is what I want? How do you go about that?
It depends on the artist, to be honest with you. So my regular interior artist, Dennis Torona, he did the main cover, which is the one with him sitting there playing video games, and he did the Psycho cover. For the main cover, he said, I have an idea. I said, great, let's see it. And this one, yep. And I said, perfect, I love it. For the Psycho cover, I very specifically told him I wanted to do an homage to Psycho, and I wanted to do the shower scene. And then he drew this for me, and I told him, like, I want the shadow of the machete and all that stuff. So that was pretty much, I directed that. With the Nintendo game one, I knew I wanted to do an homage. My artist, Jeff Bonesteel, and I kind of threw back and forth some ideas. Once we landed on this, he did all the artwork for it. And then I worked with the production guy and the colorist to add all the elements to make sure it matched up to the original. With the Ryan Brown cover, the one that you like, honestly, I love Ryan's an awesome, awesome guy. We are like separated at birth, like twins. We love all the same things. I gave him, told him what the story was about. Gave him some art or some character designs and stuff. And I said, you do what you want to do with it. And the only input I had on it was that cover, that poster in the background there. He was like, I want to do like a horror movie poster there as kind of just like a little homage. And I said, well, you and I are both huge fans of The Crow. That's how we first bonded and became friends. I was talking about The Crow.
Right there, yep.
Let's do that. That's the only input I had. Everything else, that was all his idea. And he's such a great cover artist that I didn't need to give him any ideas. I just said, here's what it's about. Make it look cool. And that's what he came up with. So it's kind of a bit of both. Sometimes I have a very clear picture in my head. And other times it's more like, hey, let's see what you got. And unless it's not awesome, then I'm going to let you run with it. And usually my artists knock it out of the park,
Oh, they do. Yeah. They absolutely do. I mean, the artwork in Red, Bright, and Broke, and maybe we'll pull up some of that work.
Sure.
I'm sure you still have some of them kicking around that we can sell for you.
Yep.
Okay. We'll talk about that in a bit.
Sure.
See what I did there? 8-bit. Talk about. Okay. All right.
I get it.
Now, I try. Wow, I've lost my train of thought. My God, nothing does makes me angry. What was I going to say? See, this is why I need a co-host here. Thanks a lot, Jamie.
About the cover.
Yes.
Take away the
two minus.
I always have five covers.
Five covers minus the three, and then you got to take the two away. Then you get to the inter. Oh yeah, Eddie Mayhem. How did you come up with the name?
So that was, you know, that was kind of a fun thing actually. It was a lot of like workshopping names. I wanted to get a very classic slasher sounding name, right? Got to have the two names, four syllables, right? Freddy Krueger, Michael Myers, Jason Voorhees, like the classics, right? But I want it to be kind of like a normal name, not like, you know, Slash Face or some weird, you know, thing like that. But I also wanted it to be something that kind of sounded at first when you first hear it. Like Michael Myers, we all know him now as a slasher, but when you first hear it, it just sounds like a regular name, right? I wanted to kind of pay tribute to the classic slashers, but also make it clear that when you hear it, there's something going on here, right? This isn't just a normal human being. So I was playing around a lot with different versions of different names. I tried playing with, you know, all sorts of, some names sounded too dorky, some names sounded too whatever. And eventually I was like, Eddie, I like, it's kind of reminiscent of Freddy, but it's different enough. And then I wanted some kind of a word that sort of represented, you know, chaos, horror, or something like that, but wasn't too on the nose, right? I didn't want to be like, you know, Eddie Machete, although that rhymes now I say it out loud. That would have been kind of cool. But, yeah. So eventually I settled on Mayhem. I was like, I like the sound of it. Eddie Mayhem, it's got the two names, the four syllables, but it does give you a little bit of a, does kind of evoke the image. You know, I wanted to make sure when people read the book that he looked and sounded like a real slasher. Like nobody has to like know his background or his origin or anything like that to kind of get the idea when you see this character that he's going to kill teenagers. You know, I wanted that sort of archetype to be there. Right? So that was kind of the inspiration for that. Yeah.
All right. But that gives me my next question. They were going to listen to a soundtrack. Read this book, what would you recommend?
Oh man, okay, so I would say if you're gonna listen to a soundtrack for this book, I would throw in probably a mix of some, I would say some like some Nine Inch Nails, just to kind of get some of the, like I'm thinking like even though I love their first album the most, but probably some like third or fourth album stuff, the real atmospheric stuff. I would also throw in some classic hair metal bands, right? Like some you're like Poison, maybe a little bit of Motley Crue, some of those, because there is kind of the 80s, you know, slasher inspiration there. I feel like you have to always have at least one really good, like, sunny pop song just to kind of, you know, be like an accent to all the other more like rock and roll stuff. You know what I mean? So something like, you know, do you remember that 90s novelty hit, New Age Girl by Dead Eye Dick? Do you remember that song? She don't eat meat, but she sure like the bone.
No.
Remember that one? No? Okay.
No! No, my brother Jeremy Courtney. Hey, brother, what's going on? What's happening? He's in the Hello. House.
Welcome.
I don't remember that, Mike. No,
you heard it. But anyway, no. My point is, I have one like really upbeat poppy song. And then let me think, what else would I have to be in there? I feel like maybe like an 8-bit like soundtrack, like the Mario Brothers, the Tetris song, you know what I mean? Like the Tetris theme, like for the chase scenes. I think that could be pretty cool. There you go.
Okay. Yeah. There you go. Perfect. All right. Yes, I get it. All right. Now, central characters.
Yes.
In the Kickstarter, all we have is Eddie.
Yeah.
No other central characters except for college kids, find a book, yada, yada, yada.
Right.
Are we going typical slasher movie characters, virgins, big booby chicks? are we going that way? I got to know. I mean, the fans got to know. We got questions coming. We got to know. Are we going classic slasher film?
So yes and no is the answer there. No, because here's the thing. I really wanted to try to get all of like the slasher film tropes into this, right? All the sort of the usual things that happen. But then I also like to subvert those things a little bit, right? And not do what people expect, you know? So what we have is a group of six teenagers. It's three girls and three guys. You've got kind of your you know, your final
Jeremy, big boobies, yay.
You've got your hot girl, you've got your smart girl, then you've got like your nerdy guy, you've got your jock, you know, all of that type of stuff. But then what I tried to do was like sort of change up the order they get killed in a little bit and stuff like that. So it wasn't completely predictable. In fact, there was one point when I was writing the script where I originally had one character die, and then I wrote the scene, and then I was kind of like, well, that's how it always goes. So I flipped it and I had the other character die. Even though I wasn't ready to kill that character, I wanted to make sure that it was like some surprises for people, you know? And what I was really happy about was actually my artist when I were talking about this, and he goes, well, I didn't see blank dying first. He's like, that took me by surprise. And I thought, okay, if I can surprise my artist who's drawing the book, then I feel like I did something right. Like then people reading the book should also be surprised, right? So yeah, so there's a lot of like classic, there is a core group of characters. I didn't go into them in the Kickstarter because they're not like, you know, they're not as visually interesting as Eddie is, right? You know, he's kind of gets the eyeballs. But there is this group of characters that I try to, you know, at least develop enough that you sort of are interested in them and care about them before they, you know, before some of them may or may not survive or die. But like I said, I tried to subvert expectations a little bit also. So hopefully it's not too predictable, you know?
Well, most slasher films are, but now this is not a slasher film. This is a slasher comic.
Right.
So what is going to make this a differential? What is going to make this be not your typical slasher? What is going to make this be different than your Freddy's, than your Jason, than your Shockers, than your Chucky's? What is going to be like? Eddie Mayhem is on a totally different playing field than all them schmucks.
Sure, I like it. By the way, nice reference to Shocker. I love Shocker. It might be the first slasher film I ever saw, actually, because I kind of came into the genre. Yeah, I came into the genre late. It was either that or Child's Play 2, and it's only because I don't remember which one came out first. Those were like the first two that I ever saw.
Carried it 2 minus 4. Shocker came out first.
All right, so that would have been the first one I ever think I ever saw. But what really sets it apart is this idea of the video game world coming into our world, right? So in the beginning of the comic, Eddie is like this 80s movie slasher who's been, you know, put into this video game as like a DLC, downloadable content character, right? Kind of like a little Easter egg type of thing. Well, when this stuff goes nuts, right, he gets sucked into the real world. And suddenly you have this you know, this video game slasher in the real world. But it's not just him. The video game world starts to come into the real world as well. So now we get this group of teenagers who's trying to fight this slasher who's, you know, invulnerable like slashers tend to be because he's made up of all these bits. But at the same time, the video game world is coming into to the real world as well. So they not only have to survive the slasher, but they have to figure out like how to get power-ups, how to heal, you know, how to fight henchmen, how to survive all of that stuff they have to deal with on top of trying not to get killed, right? And I think that's what sets it apart, is that I really tried hard to bring that video game element into it as much as I could. You know, there's so many things I wanted to put in that just there wasn't enough time for without making the page count go crazy. But I tried to hit up a lot of the big, like, the major video game classic elements and bring those into the real world. I think we have a lot of fun with it.
The guys are like knocking out of the park with the soundboard, the 8-bit stuff. Where'd you guys get that? I mean, that's like, I'm trying not to laugh here. And enough. But it's like really cool here. How many pages is it? I don't remember going through the Kickstarter and seeing the amount of pages. I mean, how many?
It started as a 48-page graphic novel, which is kind of my standard format that I'm doing now. But we just announced today, that it's actually going to be 50 pages now. We just couldn't fit it all in 48 pages. We were trying to flesh out a few scenes. We added a couple things, and now it's 50 pages. So it's a pretty chunky little book, you know what I mean? And it's a one-shot story complete. Like, it's not issue 1 of 7 or anything like that. It's like a start, beginning, you know, beginning, middle, and end. Not to say there couldn't be a sequel, because I have ideas for that. But it is a full story. You read it, you're done. You're not left going, what's going to happen next, or when is issue 2 coming out, or anything like that. So it's 50 pages.
Okay, that was my next question. Is there going to be a sequel? But you know me. I, yeah. I, wanted to know.
I would like a sequel to it, but we got to fund this one first. So that's the tricky part, right? Is it all comes down to the Kickstarters. You know, I already have the idea for the sequel kind of mapped out a little bit. But it's just a matter of, you know, getting through this one and then starting another one.
All right. Well, with that being said, let's bring up the Kickstarter. How about that? You want to bring up the Kickstarter? Let's bring up the Chrome tab, the Kickstarter. Let's share it and let Mike. I'm going to give you here you go. Now, we got the trailer here. I'm not going to play the trailer.
That's right.
Right now, as I said now, already, $5,809.
Yep.
Pledge of $7,500 is the goal. We have 194 backers, 3 days to go.
Yep.
Guys, if you're watching, if you're listening, now I know the listeners, this is going to be up. Listeners, you're going to have 2 days to go.
Right.
Viewers, public access TV, you're going to have 1 day to go. So just to let you know, get on there. Public access TV, 1 day to go, jump on there. Listeners, podcasters, 2 days to go. Live streamers, you got 3 days. So live streamers, this is your chance to jump on it now. Podcasters, listeners, you got very little time. Public access people, you got very limited time. Yep. So jump on this bad boy right now. Let's scroll down. And there's my favorite cover right there. I am like so digging this. How long did it take Ryan to do this, do you think?
A lot less than you'd expect, actually. He's a pretty fast artist. I mean, I don't know the exact amount of time, but I remember that we talked about it and settled on, you know, the details, and he had it back to me in, I don't know, a day or two. I feel like maybe, you know, a couple of days, but I mean, I he's pretty fast. So I don't think it took him. To be fair, he did send me a prelim first in a day or two. Mm-hmm. And then I said, yes, let's go for it. And then I think he turned it around in like 24 hours, I want to say. So yeah, he knocked it out.
Okay. So in the rewards, in the tiers, if say someone else besides me likes this cover, yep, and they just want this cover, can they choose what cover they want?
They absolutely can. Yes. So okay, every cover is its own tier, right? I have rewards. Just if you just want one cover, you just want to pick your cover, there's different rewards for each of those. Then there's also add-ons. So if you're like, I really like that Ryan Brown cover, but I also want this Friday the 13th cover, you can just add on the Friday the 13th or whichever other cover you want. So rather than having to make 27 different tiers where it's like, two covers, three covers, these two covers. It's just you can pick which one you want. You can add anything else onto it from there.
Now this one here, this looks like one of our other co-hosts, Jessica. Uh-huh. Hey, look, they look just like Jess. I wish she was here. It looks like they drew Jess.
Well, there you go.
Real funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's the artist edition, as I'm calling it, of the Ryan Brown cover. So his artwork looks so good in black and white that I didn't want to, you know, I love the colored version too, but I also wanted to kind of showcase his artwork a little bit. And it even has, like, if you scroll a little bit up, you see at the top, it's got like his kind of like, you know, like his paper that he draws on with his name and what the project is and everything. So if you've seen like the artist edition books where they reprint the classic, the original artwork, they do them at the full size, which I didn't do because that would cost me a lot more. But this is kind of like if you really if you just like his artwork in its purest form with no coloring and no logo or anything like that, this is the artist edition. This is going to be the most limited cover because I'm only printing enough to cover the Kickstarter. After they're done, I'll print enough for the Kickstarter and probably like 10% overage just in case of any damages or anything. And then that's going to be it. I'm not going to sell them anymore. So that one's probably going to be, I'm going to guesstimate 50 copies or so is probably all that's going to get made of that.
So is that the fifth cover?
That's the fifth cover. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. See, I was confused because you gave me four covers. You're talking about fifth covers, five covers. And I'm like, Mike, you always do five covers. I only got this. Sorry. What the hell are you talking about? All right.
That's our limited cover. Which, like I said, just so that people could sort of see Ryan's artwork in all of its original glory. You know, like I can't actually, I have the artwork for sale on the, on as one of the rewards, but it's, there's only one of them. So it's kind of like, and it's also expensive because it's a cover art. This way, if you really like his cover art and you want to feel like you own the artwork, but you don't really own the artwork, you can get it on the comic and it's kind of reproduced in the closest I can get it to the original form.
All right. Now this is my favorite part. This is what makes you want to sell. This is what makes you want to buy. Here is your rewards and your tiers. What do we got cooking here, boss?
All right. So like I said, the main cover is kind of meant to be the entry level. If you just want to read it and you don't care about different covers, that's the cheapest version I can give you. Minus there's a digital copy for $10, but for a physical copy, that's the main cover. And that's by Dennis, who's the series artist. Then most of my variants are $16 each. So you can get the Ryan Brown cover, or the Friday the 13th cover, or the Psycho cover for $16. And then the artist edition cover, because it's going to be so limited, that's the $20 book. Like I said, there's probably going to end up being about 50 copies of it. So if you're looking, if you're the type of person who likes the collectible stuff a little bit more, then you can get that. That's actually been a pretty big seller for me. I'm pretty happy with how that's been going. I mean, it's still going to probably finish around 50 copies, but I wasn't sure if I'd sell any copies of it, you know, especially when you go a little higher on the price. But we moved a dozen or two copies of that one, which I'm pretty happy about. Now, we get into the other, these are more of the combos because, you know, Outtatime Comics, which is my publishing company, we've done two previous graphic novels. We did Red, White, and Broke, which is a 120-page graphic novel, and then Uncaped, which is another 48-page, you know, one shot like this one. So these are ways for people, if you want to read everything we've done, you've got the digital version or the physical version that gets you each book, you know, so like for $40, you get all three, the 8-Bit Slasher, Red, White, and Broke, and Uncaped, you save a few bucks. And that's a great way to, if you're new to my Kickstarters, then you can get caught up and you'll have the entire Outtatime Comics collection, you know, sent to you in one package. And then there's the digital and physical combined of the two, you know, because some people want one or the other. And then this is the set. Yeah. If you want all five covers, then we have a set for that. You know, we usually move a handful of those because there are some people who like to kind of, you know, support the project. They want to get all the different covers, you know, they all come autographed by me. So we have that. And then this is kind of a fun little thing. I put together the limited collector set. I took all of our most rare comics. So there's the artist edition of 8-Bit Slasher. There's Red, White, and Broke 1 through 4 first prints, which I'm down to like less than 20 sets of, and that's it. They're never
really.
Yeah.
Good.
And then there's one of the, you get a random one of our Uncaped Virgin covers, which is, they are limited edition covers. They have no trade dress. It's just the artwork. And each one of them was between 10 and 30 copies printed, and they're individually numbered. And that's all we printed of them. And then you get digital copies of everything too. So that's kind of like, if you're a collector and you want to speculate and you're hoping that someday my books might be worth money, which I hope they are, then that would be the set that if you really want to, like, you know, drop a few bucks, get some limited edition collectibles, you know?
Okay. Now, add-ons.
Yes.
$5, get your name on the book.
Absolutely.
Now, say you want a special name on the book.
Mm-hmm.
Is it going to cost me more if I want, acknowledge me, your tribal chief, Lewis Perry? Is that going to cost me more?
You know, no, not necessarily. It just has to fit. As long as it fits within the structure of how the page is printed, then we'll put it in there. And as long as it's not inappropriate, of course, obviously, you know, I don't.
All right. So John Jingleheimer Schmidt.
That you could totally do.
That you could totally do. Because, yep, you know, his name is my name too. So I just wanted to make sure. Because whenever we go out, you know, all the people shout. So
we got to
make sure that happens.
Yep.
This is an add-on PDF cover for Uncaped, eight-bit slasher, of course. Yep. And I got to ask, any chance of a crossover?
So it's funny because I put little Easter eggs in all of my books, right? People ask, is it like all one?
That's why I'm asking.
I've been saying in interviews for a long time, like, oh, I just do that for fun. There's no real plans to cross them over. And then the more I think about it, the more I'm like, man, that would be really fun. If like Captain Stronghold and Lady Olympus teamed up against Eddie Mayhem, like I feel like that just could be a really, really fun book to write. So never say never is what I'm going to say. It's not in the plans just yet, but it could happen.
Okay. And then we're just going down. Get your name in the book.
Right. Yeah. And then I just wanted to have some other things, like I said, some kind of from the vault type of stuff. Again, for a lot of people, this might be their first exposure to Outtatime Comics, you know, so like I wanted to make sure that they had the offer to get other things. This is some interior artwork that's not colored yet, because the Kickstarter pays for the coloring and the lettering. So sometimes people are like, well, your book isn't finished. I'm like, yes, that is why Kickstarter exists, so we can finish
this. Yes.
It's very expensive to color and to letter. But you can see here, like in this panel, you can see how like she hits him and he sort of pixelates, right? Part of what makes him so hard to beat is you can't just stab him in the head, or you can't just, you know, try and, you know, stab him in the heart or something like that, or shoot him, because it's just going to pixelate. And now you've got, you know, this immortal guy. So, and that I'm really excited about. That's kind of the one of the locations that there is not really an amusement park right next to this college, but the video game brings these levels in, and one of them is the abandoned amusement park level. I've always wanted to write a book with an abandoned amusement park in it because I just really love them.
I thought it was the Jersey Shore.
Well, it's kind of inspired by that Coney Island, Jersey Shore type of thing. But yeah, abandoned theme park. And then this I just added, actually. So we had this originally as a stretch goal. So Dennis, mm-hmm. my artist, as you can see, his layouts are so detailed and so cool that it always seems like it's a waste not to share them with anybody. So
they're beautiful.
Yeah, I think so too. And I wanted to do a stretch goal where if we hit a certain amount of money, everyone's going to get like a PDF version of the whole 48-page book over again in rough form, just to kind of see the process, because like no one ever sees this except for me and Dennis. Now. Mm-hmm. It was originally a stretch goal. I don't know that we're going to hit our stretch goal at this point. I'm still trying to get funded. So, but I didn't want this to go away. So I decided to add it for free to every backer. So everybody who backs the book in any way is going to get either a physical and digital copy of the main book. And then they're going to also get a bonus digital copy of the 48-page PDF, 50 pages now PDF in the rough form, what we're calling the work print edition. So you basically are going to kind of get two books for the price of one, at least digitally. I was hoping to eventually to make enough to maybe print some copies, but that's going to be for another day, most likely, unless we get a whole lot of backers at the last minute. But at least that's kind of a neat bonus that all the backers are going to get this digital copy of the work print edition, which will let them really see all the artwork in its, you know, kind of initial laid out form. I'm real excited about that. I think it's gonna be a lot of fun.
I am digging this right here, because this is like bringing me into movies right now. Slasher moves for the first time. Yep. And goes, I can see this not as a comic, but as a movie.
I mean.
Exactly, you know where I'm going.
Hollywood's ears, you know what I mean? Like
exactly. I mean, we talked about this before. I talked about Red, Right, and Broke being an animated series because it's that good. This right here, this shot that everyone's viewing on the screen. I'm going to stop sharing in a minute. This could be right out of a movie.
Yep. Yeah, I think. And, awesome. And with the CGI and everything.
Absolutely. Now, yes. Great. All right, we got some comments coming through. Let's see, Axel's in the house saying, hey, how's it going, gentlemen? Definitely checking it out.
Thank you.
And Sean Scott says, Daydreaming Comics, hell yeah. Shout out to Lewis Berry for always great running a great show. Thank you, Sean. Definitely share this Kickstarter on Daydreaming Comics. This is Angry Geeks approved. We gotta back it, we gotta get it up and out there. This is like amazing. And
I'm just going to pimp it out a bit. If it does become a movie, just think how valuable these comics are going to be eventually, because we're talking low print runs compared to your Marvel and DC stuff. You know what I mean? So
for sure.
Get there, this will be a real collectible.
Yes, it would be. I mean, and slasher films get bought up very quick.
Yep.
Because they are cheap to make.
Right.
They are. I mean, they, and I don't know how to put this without sounding like a jerk. You don't have to act well to be in a slasher film.
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
I'm sorry. Now, I know actresses and actors that are in slasher films, and I'm so sorry, and you guys know who I'm talking about, and I'm not disrespecting you, ladies. I'm just saying, other people, like your understudies and people coming up, you ladies are fantastic. You guys knock it out of the park. I'm talking about other people, you know, the people that are just breaking up. You don't have to act to be in a slasher film.
Right.
I don't want to be in trouble. No, I love you guys.
We'll just call them easy to make, we'll say.
Yes, they are very easy and very cheap to make.
Yeah.
I mean, you're only paying for your top stars that can act. Like,
right.
I'm talking about you ladies. And no. So, yes. And then the rest of them, it's just like, whatever.
Yeah.
You know, you're just paying it because they are so easy to make.
Yep.
Fake blood is cherry syrup. There you go.
Exactly.
You know what? I got 4K cameras all over the place. Mike, we're going to make this into a movie. Netflix, all here right. we come.
That sounds good.
I think, yes. I mean, it's we can make this in a backyard in a green screen for crying out loud. This is magic in a bottle. You guys got to get this book. Jump on it right now. I'm telling you, get this Kickstarter, get it funded. Even if it's a PDF copy, you know, that's not going to be too collectible. You got to get the physical stuff.
Yep.
Get the physical stuff, hold it in your hands. That's what you want. Okay.
And I will say too, just for people who are watching, you know, like when we have our books, let me see if I can find one here. Like, so this is a copy of Uncaped, one of the limited ones, right? But all of my books are square bound, so it's hard to see it on the thing. But this isn't just like a stapled floppy, right? This is like what we used to call prestige format. It's like a graphic novel format, you know. And then the covers are like this beautiful thick cardstock. And then when you look inside, you can see like they're printed on like premium paper. You know, the colors just like really pop off the page. You know, the artwork looks just fantastic. Like, see what I mean? Like, I always tell people, like, it's hard to capture it on camera, but I tell people, like, at conventions and stuff, like, when you come to a convention at my table and you pick up one of my comics, like, it doesn't feel like a regular
run,
like, you know?
No.
It feels hefty. It feels like a real book, you know? And I'm very proud of how they look, you know, compared to a lot of other books. You know, this is Red, White, and Broke. It's a nice, big, thick, you know, book. Like I always feel like just take a look, hold one of my comics in your hands. And I think you'll agree that it does not feel like a lot of what you get from, you know, some of the other indie comics that are out there. I'm not knocking other indie comics. Believe me, I'm not an expert. It took me a while to kind of figure out, you know, what I wanted to do. But I do think that now when you see them, when you feel them, when you hold them, you know, it's a real tactile experience. I think the quality, you know, it's like heavyweight paper and thick covers and, you know, just really top notch. Like I said, the colors just pop, you know. And I'm a fan of how my books turn out. Now most of that goes to everybody other than me, because I'm the writer, right? But the colorist, the artist, the letterer, the printing company does such a great job printing. They're awesome to work with. And that's what I think when you get the book in the mail or you pick it up at a convention, I think most people are not disappointed with you know. Well, hopefully they're not disappointed with reading it, but at least with how it looks and feels and how it holds in your hands, I think it's a really a top quality experience. I think that's important. You know, if I'm asking people to take a chance on my book and you don't know who I am, I'm not a famous guy or anything, I think I have to deliver something more than just like, hey, here's some pages I stapled together. Hope you enjoy them, you know?
Wait a minute. After the intro I gave you,
yeah.
Award-winning podcaster, author, best-selling author,
yep.
And you're saying you're not a famous guy. I would beg to differ, my good man.
All right.
That is time for question of the week.
Okay.
And it's going to be kind of bland this week. But anyway, question of the week, as always, is brought to us by Alternate Universe LLC, Milford and New Haven. If you don't have an LCS near you, call Eric. Get in touch with Mr. Eric Yakko on Facebook, Instagram, Alternate Universe. Send him a message. He will mail your comics flat, just like Stan Lee did back in the days. Remember? Mail flat. Mail to you flat. He will do that to you. If you're looking for a back issue, he's got back issues. Message him. He'll dig through the back issues. See if he got them. You want wall books? He's got wall books. He got slabbed. He got raw. Let him know, and he will get it to you if he can. If not, Milford don't have it, maybe New Haven can. He's got toys as well. Just contact Eric and the guys and they will set you up. Make sure you let them know they're Angry Geeks approved and that the Angry Geeks sent them. Mike, first question.
Maybe.
If allowed to be the opposite sex just for a day, how will your looks be and what would you do? Those of you watching live, please answer the question if you dare. If allowed to be an opposite sex just for a day, how will your looks be and what would you do? And since we only have Mike, I will answer that question as well.
Okay. Mike. You know what? I think if I was going to be a female, that would be the opposite sex for me for a day. What my looks, I would honestly, I'm gonna be a little shallow here. I would want to look like a supermodel. I would want to look like a Kate Upton or like Ana de Armas, because I want to know what that's like. You know what I mean? Like, I want to know what it's like to be just somebody who is just unquestionably hot, because, you know, rumor on the street is they get treated a little bit differently than us regular people, and I wouldn't know, and I want to know what that's like. I want to know what it's like for people to, like, turn their heads as I walk down the street. You know what I mean? So that's what I think I would look like. What would I do? I mean, I'm gonna keep this above board. There's a lot of things I could say with that answer, but I think what I would do is definitely be like, yeah, I would take advantage of those supermodel looks, and I think I would go out on the town, you know what I mean, and like hit up a restaurant, hit up a bar, go to like a party, and just sort of like drive in a convertible and just sort of see what the world is like. The world is my oyster, you know, being just like unquestionably drop dead gorgeous human being. I want to know what that's like. I feel like that'd be an interesting experience for me.
Okay.
That's my answer.
Well, for me, as the song says, I like my look, my women a little bit on the trashy side.
All right.
I mean, look how I dress now. I would definitely, I mean, dude, look at the way I dress. Come on. I mean, you see the way I dress. You see the other pictures of me.
Yep.
My brother Jeremy, he just looks, my kids are embarrassed to go out with me because of the way I dress, you know, the ripped jeans, the flashy jeans. I dress like Elvis. I mean, I think it looks classy. Everyone else says it looks gaudy. I would definitely be a hoochie mama. Okay. I would be me, but a female version. I would be to the nines. I would be busting out. Okay. But I would be flaunting it.
I like it.
Even if I didn't have it, I would be flaunting. I would be flaunting it. That's what I would be. And I mean, you think these outfits are outlandish? I would to the nines.
Mm-hmm.
To the nines.
Well, what are you gonna do with time as a hoochie mama? Your 24 hours.
24 hours as a, I would have a ball. I would see how far I could take it without getting arrested or
in trouble. Okay. I like that.
That's I mean, I wouldn't put it out there, but I would just take it to that line.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, space is the place and the sky's the limit.
Right.
That's exactly what I would do. I would be me.
Yep.
But as a hoochie mama.
Okay.
So I would be on the same level, but as a hoochie mama.
Okay.
And just to see how far I could take it and to see if I could get away with more as a hoochie mama than as me.
Right.
I bet you I could. I bet you any amount of money I can get away with more as a hoochie mama than as me.
I wouldn't doubt it. I wouldn't doubt it.
I bet you. All right. Question number two.
Mm-hmm.
What is the most embarrassing thing you've ever... Who wrote these questions tonight? What is the most embarrassing thing you've ever worn?
Man.
Mike.
I don't know that, like, my wardrobe really lends itself to a lot of embarrassment. First of all, I don't get embarrassed very easily or almost at all. Mostly, I wear a lot of t-shirts, like t-shirts of, you know, comic books, movies, things like that. I can't necessarily think of anything embarrassing that I've ever worn. But I will say I've had bad luck with being embarrassed by wearing things at inopportune times as the same as other people. So like when I was in eighth grade, the Batman movie came out, right? And I bought all these Batman t-shirts. And then I found one night.
Well, we all did.
Yeah, right. But I was at this department store and they had this one of these all over print shirts, right? These really gaudy, like, and it had a Batman head that must have been 2 feet tall on it. And it was bright yellow and black all over. And the back of it had the back of his head. It was just like this really loud t-shirt. And I was all
excited. I think I have it.
Oh, you probably do. And I was all excited to wear it to school on Monday morning, right? This was like right after the Batman movie came out. And I go to school wearing it. And the kid who sat right next to me in my homeroom class shows up wearing the exact same shirt. So here we are, the two of us like twins wearing these glow-in-the-dark Batman giant gaudy shirts. And everybody was like, what the hell's going on? Are you guys wearing that? Did you do that on purpose? And this and that. And I was like, oh, man. So that was really like painful to just like have my thunder stolen. You know what I mean? And then I had another similar when I was in a band back in the day, and I got this like crushed velvet shirt. You know, I was looking all cool, like a rock star. We were playing this huge gig, and there was literally a guy in the audience wearing the exact same shirt. And it was very obvious that because it was like bright and like you couldn't mistake it. And it was like, well, that, so I changed out of that shirt. It was just like, you know, so I seem to have, like my embarrassing clothes moments come from wearing the same things as other people for some reason.
The band thing, I would have played it off.
Yeah.
Being who I am, I would have been like, my number one fan in the audience, thank you very much, brother. I appreciate you coming to see me dressing like me because, yeah, you wanted to be just like me, but you know what? You can't be me because he ate me. That's what it is. But, yeah, I would have dug it. I would have got so much heat from that. Yeah. Oh.
I think if that happened to me now, I would lean into it like that. But this was when I was a much younger man, and it was just like, oh, no, we're wearing the same shirt. We can't have that, you know. And so, but I think now I totally lean into it for sure.
No, dude, I would have been all over that. I would have been like, wow. Now, see, it was funny. I went to an event, and I had on my macho robe. Mm-hmm. And the one that he wore at SummerSlam, it was the glitter one, the white one and everything with the stars. And it was the silver one with the stars. And this lady had on a sweater that was the same thing.
Oh, wow.
But it didn't say Macho Man on it. Right, and right. I walked right up there and said, hey, isn't it great that we didn't wear the same outfit? She just looked at me and started laughing. Right. You know, then it started raining, so I had to put it away because I didn't want it to get wrecked.
Well, sure.
My most embarrassing.
I think the same way about you though, Lewis. Like, what would you have worn that would be embarrassing? I can't imagine you wear outlandish clothes. So like, what's going to embarrass you? Like a suit?
When Rose and I got married,
yeah,
I wore now pink. I wear pink all day long. I don't care. But I had a pink shirt on and I had black like slacks on.
Right.
But I had Superman slippers on.
Ah, nice.
So once we said I do, we got married in the house. I ran back inside and I changed. Right. I threw on a pair of ripped shorts and a Superman t-shirt. And that's how I went to the reception. To me, anything that's stuffy is embarrassing to me. I can't do it. I can't, like polo shirts, anything like that. No, right. I can't. I got to wear my colors, man. I have to have a shirt with Superman, Batman, Thor. I have Kiss. I have Macho Man, Drew McIntyre. I have to have a wrestling shirt, a comic book shirt, a Kiss t-shirt, an Elvis t-shirt. I have to have me. I have to be me.
Well, I do want to point out, because I feel the same way, even though I have what I like, this is sort of my outfit. I like to have the overshirt, because I can't remember, but I am wearing, for those who couldn't see it, it's a Frog and Toad t-shirt, you know, from the books, a Frog and Toad. So I didn't want people to think, like, I'm not wearing some, like, stuffy buttoned-up shirt. I got a Frog and Toad t-shirt that I'm rocking today, and then I put it over it, you know what I mean? So
I mean, I always, as Jeremy, Stevie Oakes, the real life Peter Griffin, everybody, I always accessorize. I have to, you know, because it's me. And wearing embarrassing stuff to me is like dressing normal. Yeah, it's like my wife would go, oh, these khakis are nice. I'm like, no.
I have just gotten a Hawaiian shirt with my face all over it.
Oh, that's awesome.
I just got one. But I'm gonna.
Yes.
I didn't think to wear it tonight. I should have. Yeah. It's upstairs right now. But I did just where get one of that. I'll be debuting in a couple of days.
It's over there. It was a little chilly in here. I was gonna wear one of the Macho Man jackets tonight.
Yeah.
With all the fringe on it. I put it over there. I was like, I was gonna wear, but I started to get hot. No, I gotta. I mean, even my shades. I have to be me. It's not. I was told by one of our networks that the Angrygeeks are a spot of yellow and a sea of red.
Okay.
Because we stand out, and that's what I got to do. I was always that way, dude. And it's like, no, I'm not feeding into the spotlight. I'm not. It's just that it's me. It's just who I am.
I dig it.
Anything other than what I have to wear is embarrassing.
Right, right.
Plain and simple.
Makes plain sense. Plain
and simple. All right. We are just about out of time. We got 4 minutes left.
Okay.
Let's talk about the Kickstarter one more time.
Sure.
How many days left do we got?
3 days.
3 days. And like I said, viewers right now, live streamers, you got 3 days. Podcast listeners, you have 2 days. Public access TV people, you have 1 day. Get to the website. We already had it up.
Yep.
It's in, going to be in your little description here.
Mm-hmm.
Click the link. Go there. Back this project. Okay? It's awesome. It's going to be awesome. If you are a horror movie fan, you're going to like it. I know it. Okay? If you're an 8-bit classic video game player, you're going to love it. Okay? The artwork is fantastic. I mean, look at this stuff. Okay? I mean, how could you not like, especially that cover right there? Yep. How can you not like that? That is what Mike said, the most popular version right going today. If you want that, you better hurry up because they might be sold out. You don't want to be sold out if you want one of these. Just go there and no, get that off there. And this idiot, go there and get that right now. Get those books, get the tiers, get your name in the book. Extra $5.
That's good.
You spend the $16, $5, carry the two. That's $21. Get your name up in lights. There you go. Have fun. Okay. Yeah. Treat yourself for Easter. Easter's coming. Easter bunny. Go ahead and do it. You're a collector. Collect the books. Mike, where can people find you?
So on all the social medias, it's at Out of Time Comics, and that's spelled like they see on the screen here. It's OUTTA Time, Out of Time, all one word. Out of Time Comics. So you can find me there on Instagram, on TikTok, on Facebook. We have, of course, outoftimecomics.com. And then, of course, on Kickstarter, you actually have to search by my name, Mike Spring, on Kickstarter. But then you can see the current campaign as well as any of the older campaigns. You just want to see what they look like. But yeah, Out of Time Comics and all the socials, I'm pretty active on most all of them. So track me down, follow, throw me a like, all that good stuff. And, you know, I'll keep you entertained, hopefully.
And I am Lewis Perry. In the next coming weeks, we're going to have some other awesome guests. And yeah, the entire crew is going to be back here. So we will play another round of Do You Know Me? Mike got away pretty easy tonight, not playing Do You Know Me? So without further ado, I'm Lewis. This is Mike Spring. Get the book. And I'm going to be signing out for Pod TV and Real Vibe TV. Find us on your public access television station. And listen to us wherever your favorite podcasts are found.